Om Sri Sairam. Sairam brothers and sisters, welcome to the 12th edition of Samarpan program here at the Sarvadharma Service Center in Farmingdale Borough, Howell Township, New Jersey, United States. Today, I have the honor to introduce our Samarpan speaker, Dr. Chanderraju Hanumantha Rao. Dr. Rao is a medical graduate from Warangal in Telangana, India. He was born in Secunderabad, India, as the youngest of nine children, five sisters and four brothers. He was blessed to be one of the four doctors in this family. After working with the railways as a medical officer for a couple of years, he moved to the Sultanate of Oman for two more years, and later to the Islamic Republic of Iran for six very eventful years. Eventful because it was during the post-revolutionary period, as well as during the Iran-Iraq War. Dr. Rao wore many hats in this period. As the medical officer in charge of many medical facilities, as the medical officer in charge of the addiction program for Malayer City in the province of Hamadan, as the in charge of malaria control program, introducing WHO program of oral rehydration salts into the population. Besides this, he organized health education programs on various topics in several villages, including school health programs. Local Iranians invited him for various community welfare meetings in the mosques with their religious heads. To him, Iran was, and is still, understandably, home away from home. Later, back at the Sultanate of Oman, for another 13 years, Dr. Rao worked for the Ministry of Health as a medical officer in charge of Tanam Central Hospital and other medical facilities around Al Dahira region, besides the Center for Disease Control, Ibri District. During his tenure in Ibri, Dr. Rao was actively involved in several community activities. He was one of the founder members of the Indian School branch in Ibri. He was nominated by the then ambassador of India to the Sultanate of Oman to be a member of the Indian School, Ibri, for a three-year term, and was renominated for another two terms. In 2014, on the occasion of the Ibri School's Silver Jubilee celebrations, he was felicitated by the Indian ambassador, as well as the Minister of Education for Sultanate of Oman. He was also instrumental in starting a sports cultural club in Tanam Central Hospital, Ibri, and was actively involved with local administration for National Day celebrations in Oman, which included sports events, cultural programs, and other festivities. After his illness in late November 1999, where Swami gave him a second lease of life, he returned to India and was blessed by Swami to join Sri Sathya Sai Institute of Higher Medical Sciences, popularly called as a super specialty hospital in Whitefield, Bangalore, from the year 2000 to 2012. He served in the cardiology department, being in charge of screening patients and counseling. Later, he served as the medical superintendent at the Brookfield Hospital in Bangalore. Dr. Rao has conducted many medical seva camps in India, serving the needy wherever he saw one. His wife, Sister Uma Devi, who is also here with us today, is also a physician and has been a pillar of support for him all along. Dr. Uma Devi is one of the three physician sisters of our very own sister, Dr. Vani Andavolu. And so, Dr. Rao Andavolu, both are same names, so I'm going to call him Dr. Rao Andavolu, who is one of the trustees of a center, happens to be his co-brother. The Raos have two sons and two grandsons. So with this, I would like to invite Dr. Rao to the podium and request him to share with us his experiences with Swami for the next hour or so. Welcome, Dr. Rao. Sairam.
Well, Sai Ram, Om Sri Sai Ram Gurudeva Datta. I invoke the blessings of, I'm getting a little emotional. To invoke the blessings of Bhagwan upon all his loved ones. Om Ganeshaya Namaha, Bismillah Rahmanur Rahim. In the name of the Lord Almighty, who has been the breath of all religions. He is the King of Kings, most loving, caring. My Divine Mother, praying for your grant grace of benevolence, blessings upon all his loved ones. I offer my reverential salutations at his lotus feet, Bhagwan. As we always know, he's omniscient and omnipresent. But still, I still do want to invoke him through this lovely Sufi rendering of, I offer it to Swami. Can you? It's an audio video clipping.
Faja ji ya gharib nawaz, ya gharib nawaz, ya gharib nawaz, ya
Faja, 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 faja
Sai Ram to all elders and the Sai family. My gratitude unto Swami for considering and granting me this opportunity to be standing here to share a little bit of what I've seen, experienced, being touched with love and care of Bhagwan. It has been a long, winding road with ups and downs, times of despair, where he never hesitated to hold on and to lift me up. Well, that's the care of mother to the child, as I always see it, and address him as Divine Mother. I pray to Swami to continue his grace, benevolence, and all he can to all the loved ones, all through, ever after. It has always been in my heart, soul, and mind that this breath of his, what he has granted, I feel, yes, every bit of it has to be shared with someone who needs it. Love, care, the affection, and what we could do to uplift them in their despair. Illness, call what you may. When in our lives, we always have seen, experienced such kind of situations where we needed somebody's help. In some form or the other, the divine comes in, steps in, maybe not immediately, for some immediately, yes. But then there's a word called patience, sabri. Shraddha is not just important. Sabri is more important. You must have patience with Lord. I will just have a short prelude to the last week's Saturday's bhajan. Bhajans have always been enchanting, come what may, how the voice is. But when you look into Swami's eyes, feel him through it, it energizes you. It was in my mind, a flashback of Swami in one of my dreams, asking me to sing a bhajan Srinivasa. I don't share much of a dreams with my wife, Uma, but I thought I should share it here. It was the Srinivasa bhajan. I started singing two lines and he said, Inka Chalu in Telugu, and raised his hand and disappeared. Immediately as I opened my eyes, the very same bhajan was started by a Sai sister Bharati, right? Your name? She started that. And that is his immediate request. which flows into devotees, knowingly or unknowingly, but that's a grant. That's the little bit of wish what he can push into people, energize. And that melody, no words can describe the joy in abundance, unasked for, but yet granted. That's divine mother, love, affection. Well, on devotion and desires, everybody seems rather very keenly think that we are devoted. I've seen many a times people on scooters driving, they find a Shirdi Baba under a tree. They just offer the salutations like this and just go drive on. Well, that fraction of a second what they conveyed to him, I think that's more immense with energy and power, which he pulled him that he could remember the Lord sitting under the tree on the pavement. It's small, not a temple as such. Well, others stop by, remove the footwear, pray for a minute, while others also do the pradakshina for the tree. It depends upon the time what they can devote to give the devotion and offer their prayers to the Lord. Well, as always Swami said, in Kali Yuga, the only way you can touch, feel, experience, and be and merge with God is Namasmarana, Bhagavan Namasmarana. I think each one of us do it. Well, I think that's the only solace what I can do. I don't read much of books of Swami. But then this little Namasmarana, I think, gives me abundance of energy at any given point of time, day or night. So coming to the desires, well, everyone has got enough number of desires. And I, like a child to a mother, had many a desire. It could be petty when I narrate these to you. It could be thinking, oh, why is this talking about this kind of a desire? But then it was a child to mother. I go about with this, about certain of my desires, which Swami lovingly, caringly gave it to me. As I always say, ye dil mange more, thirst, hunger for the love of nectar of Swami never ends. You might not want it, but he will want to give it to you. So with open hands, we must accept. So did I have to our love, sweet Lord, and he did show his love. At a very young age, as I remember, recall, maybe 10 years old, we had a puja room in the house where no space was left on the walls. Deity photos were there, and that was a puja room. I vaguely remember a Shirdi Baba's picture and our Satya Sai Baba's small photo. My mother did not tell me anything about it. Every day morning, we used to just light a lamp there and walk off. But I remember that. And I thought, and I still think, that was the beginning of the touch of his love in this life. Well, now, on the road to Swami, 1979, December, it was the day December 5th that Uma came into my life and we got wedding day. A day which I should say was an awakening with Shirdi Baba and Satya Sai Baba. The family was more devoted. And yes, I thought I should, and I did follow. So that's one thing where I can tell you my awakening with Shirdi Baba and Satya Sai Baba. Well, from then on, till mid-90s in Vrindavan, every year we used to go for darshans. In one such of these visits, the last day before we were leaving back to Hyderabad, that day the darshan was in the Kalyana Mandapam. And yes, my wife and mother-in-law managed to get in the lady's side into the Kalyana Mandapam, but my two sons were with me and we could not get into the Kalyana Mandapam. So we were sitting under the trees opposite the hall, and my younger son, Vishnu, young boy, about maybe 7-8 years, I'm not sure, said, "Dad, go and ask that uncle, that is a Sevadal." He didn't know that they were Sevadal, but he said, "Go and ask that uncle." I took courage and walked up to him and I requested him, "See, I'm leaving and my two sons are there. We want to have a darshan." He didn't say a word. He opened the second door and he took us inside. On the third block, center aisle seat, he gave me, said, "Sit down here, but your children should be sitting behind you. When Swami comes, please do not let them come forward." I said, "Okay, fine." Darshan started. Swami came in. First two blocks, he just moved about for 5-6 minutes, if I remember. Then came and stood in front of the person sitting in front of me. Just a prelude to this, I wrote a small slip saying that, "Swami, I allowed to have Pada Namaskar." Well, if you think that is also not so, at least a clear vision of your feet. And I put it into the post box just over the Vrindavan that side and came for this darshan. When I sat down there and Swami came, the person sitting in front of me, he interacted with him for some time, maybe a minute or so. And then the person bowed down, lifted the robes of Swami to take Pada Namaskars. And that was the time when I could clearly close up vision of Swami's feet, my joy newborns. I wrote this to Swami before coming here, and he's showing me his feet, not the Pada Namaskar, but at least he's granted me that vision. Happy I was at that. Then my visit to Parthi in 2020, it was as late as 6 p.m. when I entered into the hall and when Swami was leaving for Vrindavan in his red Mercedes Benz and was in the center pathway of the towards the mandir and going out. All people gathered much lower up, but I was on the top at the last pillar alone, standing there. I prayed to Swami. As the car passed by, the car stopped there. The windows rolled down and Swami turned and with both his hands looking up to me. There was nobody else standing there. I also prayed to Swami and immediately again the car started and left. See, even that kind of a small wish that maybe even when he was leaving, he thought he should not disappoint me. I think I was more than happy. My prayers answered. Sai Ram, Amin and Amen. Peace be upon him. Well, after returning to India in 1999 due to illness, I registered in Satya Sai Institute of High Medical Sciences, Puttaparthi, for a bypass surgery. Much later, again went for darshans. I wanted to have a rather interaction with Swami for my health. I could not get a proper place to sit. I was leaving the next day. Disappointed I was walking out. An old man came and tapped my shoulder and said, "Why are you so disappointed?" I said, "Yes, I needed this and I wanted an interaction with Swami somehow or the other." Then he said, "You go and meet Janakrame Garu, late Janakrame Garu, Swami's brother." So I got his residence and went to him. Then he gave me a slip for the blessings. I came much early at about 12 o'clock noon. Sitting there in the sun. Then he said, "Why don't you go and sit there? The Sevadal told you too early for the darshan." Anyway, I waited there. And I was the first to be entered for the security. I didn't know, but my footsteps were running. I think I was running for find a good place there to sit down. Immediately, two sevadals scooped onto me from behind, caught hold of me and said, "You're running here without any discipline and all that," and took me out. The chief of in charge of sevadal around that area "You seem to be educated, but you don't follow disciplines of Swami. Why are you running here? Laga, bahar, bahar laga do." They put me out of the gate. Much disappointed, displeased at the way it is happening. Loudly I said, "This is the house of God. Nobody can stop people here. A child going into the house of Lord." Three times I repeated, "No," went unheeded. Immediately, a hand touched my shoulder from the back and said, "Shanti, don't worry." So he said, "You go to meet Chiranjeevi Rao, secretary of the ashram." I went to him because it was about nearing two and Swami's time, Chiranjeevi was coming outside. I went in and told him, he took me inside, "Tell me quickly." I narrated what happened. He said, "No, I cannot believe this. My Sevadal or Swami Sevadal can do this to you. Nobody can touch anybody like that." I said, "It did happen." He said, "Come with me." He took me to that room, Sharedigar's room near the entrance. I called the Sevadals inside and said, "Can you identify them?" I identified four of them. Chiranjeevi Rao asked, "Did you touch him?" They said, "Yes." "Did you put him out?" "Yes." Then immediately third sentence was, "Apologize to him." I cried and said, "Please, I don't want an apology. I wanted Swami's darshan and blessings. If you can give me that, that's more important. I don't want this." And immediately Swami is coming in. Music started and he started coming inside. And quickly they took me inside and put me in a place where Swami least would have gone to the pillar in a wedge. It was like that. Nobody was sitting. They put me in the pillar, in front of the pillar. Anyway, I sat. Swami was about 5-6 feet away. I loudly said, "Swami." He turned back and said, showed his hand and said, "Wait." He came, stood in front of me, took my letter. I mean, I did not know anything what happened between this time when Swami came, stood, taking my letter, tapping it on my cheek, tapping it on my forehead. I was crying. He gave me pada namaskars, took the letter and walked away. The darshan, after the darshan and everything, bhajan was over. An elderly man again was sitting just by my side. He said, "I've been seeing some afternoon what happened to you. They put you outside, but you came in and Swami came to you." And this is all he narrated. I said, "I don't know anything what happened, but I thought that is the love of mother. No matter what anybody, but if he's there, you don't have to worry. Why fear when he is there?" That's what rings into my ears every time when I look upon Swami or any other deity around. I will go to joining Swami's hospital. It's something which came unexpected out of the blue. I went to Vrindavan for darshans. I wrote a letter to Swami requesting for seva and all that. I don't know why I made 7 copies of them in the Xerox outside. Every day for darshan, I used to take one. Swami comes, I give it to him. I was wondering back, why did I give it? He's coming, he's taking 3rd day, 4th day, 5th day, 6th day, 7th day. The last copy, I don't know how he is well. He planned it. He accepted the letter. Swami started walking. Padmanabhan, Dr. Padmanabhan, who always walks behind Swami in Vrindavan, as Swami walked, he came back. He said, after darshan, you meet me at Kalyana Mandapam. After I go with Swami to come back, I'll see you. I ran after darshan, stood there. Dr. Padmanabhan came back and said, Swami has blessed you. He has asked you to go and meet Dr. Safaya in the hospital today, now. Go there and meet him. But one thing, don't delay it. Go now. I left barefoot. I forgot my slippers there, went, took an auto, went to the hospital. The people, Sevadal, were all new. They didn't think that I was called by the director. Somebody called the director's office. The secretary came out and she said, you're a doctor? Okay, come. No questions asked. No certificates. He said, yes, Swami has instructed. I was waiting for you. You were delayed. I said, this is the thing happened. It's all right. In 45 minutes, the letter was ready, the appointment letter. But then he said in that letter, you can go and join in Puttaparthi. I said, why, sir? I wanted to be in Whitefield. He said, are you sure? I said, yes. Can you read this? This is yours, right? Your handwritten. See, Swami sent this to the hospital. And it's very clearly mentioned there that I have written and I have signed Puttaparthi, Whitefield. I said, sir, I do not know how this happened. Well, anyway, don't worry. Swami is kind enough. It will happen. When do you want to join? He said, I join after Guru Purnima. So that is how Swami also gives a way for changing what he has planned to your convenience. And that's how I think he planned it. And I was doing some seva in the screening block in charge and the counseling patients on after the OPD. On the first anniversary of Satya Sai Institute of Higher Medical Sciences, Swami came there, and it was the first day was all the program of and all that. The second day he was giving interview to the doctors and the administrative staff, and nobody told me about it. I was in the OPD as usual and doing my work. A Sevadal came to me and said, why are you sitting here when all doctors have been called by Swami? Go run to the interview room. I ran there and the door was just going to be closed. I pushed myself inside. And Swami looked at the door and he said, I went and sat in the last row. I mean, that was the only place left. After interacting for about 40 minutes, he was seeing us off. And I was the last to exit. Stood in front of Swami with folded hands like this. He held my hand like this, played with the fingers and the rings, and told me smilingly, what can I give you? You have so many rings. I said, these are all given by you, Swami. I don't need anything. I need only your blessings. Immediately, he showed me his feet, said, take Pad Namaskars. I quickly bowed down. As I finished the Pad Namaskars, he gently pushed me to the out and the door closed. And that is what is the love of Swami is. In one of the Vrindavan darshans, when we used to go, when Swami was there, I was away in Hyderabad for a couple of days. I wasn't there for the darshan. Swami came to the hospital block and was inquiring with the farm boys of Swami working in the hospital. He showed his hands like this to them and said, where is that ring, doctor? You're not here today. Yesterday also, he was not here. They all laughed at his Swami's humor. I mean, afterwards, after I returned back to Bangalore, the boy said, what a great guy you are, doctor, your rings and all that. He told everybody and we all laughed. I said, I was in my heart, I was happy. At least in my absence, he remembered me. And now that's the love of a mother to a child. It was felicitation of doctors in Satya Sai Institute for the first anniversary in Vrindavan. Well, even now for this, I wasn't told about it. It was sudden that Swami decided that he should felicitate all the doctors. And probably some communication gap. I was not informed. I usually, after my screening block, came back home to have a lunch, quick lunch. And Mr. Gulati, Swami is very dear devotee. He's an ex-Colonel Gulati, as he is loved called. No more late. He saw me and he said, "Hey, Doc, what are you doing here?" I said, "I just came to have a bite." He said, "No, run. Swami called by 1:30. You should be there in Vrindavan. All the doctors are there." I just rushed there. And luckily, I was the last deformed line by the side of the Vrindavan podium of Swami. And yes, I was asked to sit. Swami lovingly called everyone individually to the altar and shawl blessed upon giving and a bag gift containing a watch, which I still adore. I still wear it today. And gave padanamaskars. Well, before I just cut short this, I will tell you about another instance when Swami, we were sitting in the veranda, we used to see people going into the interview room, flashlights occurring and all that, Swami taking pictures with them. Absolutely, you're from outside, you were thinking that Swami is granting them pictures. In my mind, I used to think, Swami, when will you give us an opportunity like this? That was my mind when I left the darshan that day. 2 weeks later, Sunday, after the darshan was over and people were just rushing outside from the veranda side, outside, one person tapped my shoulder and said, "This envelope is for you." I just took it in a rush and put it on the dashboard and drove back, and I didn't know about it. I came back. When I came back, I saw on the dashboard, there was an envelope. And in that envelope, there was a picture of Swami standing like this in front. And I was there in the picture with my hands folded like this. My face and this blue ring signet was visible in that. That was the only way to indicate that I was also there in the picture. I said, "Swami, you gave me a picture, but there was nothing on my face there. Only this ring." See, that was the love of Swami for giving me, after 2 weeks, a photograph, though not my complete picture. But then he showed that. Same in Vrindavan after this anniversary on the felicitation. Over 2 weeks later, one of the Swami's boys came and said, "Hey, doctor, we saw your photo with the Swami. It was with the lecturer in Vrindavan." During the lunchtime, I went to Vrindavan, called Mr. Rajendran. I went and searched for him. He came. I said, "Sir, I understand there are the photographs." He said, yes, I have a couple of photographs. You can have a look at them." I do not know whether it was pre-arranged or what. He removed three photos in a sequence from that album and gave it to me and said, "These three are yours." I again saw, first one was my back, from my back, Swami in front, giving the shawl like this, my face not there. The second one I saw, it was from again this side. I was feeling desperate. The third one when I saw, it was actually from this side where my face was little visible and Swami's face was also to the side turned. This is how Swami is. He waits for you. He wants to grant. But then you must have patience with the Lord. That's how it happens with a small petty wishes. I can also recall, I will tell you this one little instance when I went to Parthi. After the supper, came back to the room S7 in the ashram. Normally, I was being given that S7 room. I sat there. I felt like having an ice cream. Never did I feel like I'm eating an ice cream. But then I said, I just want to have an ice cream. So I just walked to this shopping complex. Maybe the shop is open. The ice cream shop was next. But then they were closed. they were closing. He said, we can't, accounts closed. The lady was standing there with four ice creams. She saw me depressed or maybe like that. And she said, you can have one. I can give you one. So I took it and I wanted to pay. She said, no payment. So I took it and started walking back to the 7. At the same time, the whole lane where that S7 block is, lights, street lights were dim. Or maybe the lighting was very dark. Halfway down that, I walked. I wanted to open it and start eating. Suddenly, I felt somebody pulling my kurta from behind, holding my kurta and pulling me. I turned back. I found a small boy, about 6 to 7 years old, or maybe 8 years old. I asked him, what do you want? Ice cream. He said, for a long time, I wanted to have an ice cream, and somebody is asking me to give it to him. I said, he's a small boy, let me give. So I opened it and gave a scoop to him. He said, no. I said, take it, I'm giving you ice cream. He wanted the whole cup. I said, oh Lord, you're testing me. He said, poor child. I gave it to him. He just took that ice cream, he didn't even put it into his mouth, and started running in front of me, just 5-6 steps, and he disappeared. I just can't believe this, even till today. Many things I did not narrate. But then this happened, he disappeared. And there lo, in glow of white, stood at least 7 feet tall, in white robes, glowing eyes. I could realize that Shirdi Baba was there standing and smiling. Just a few seconds, disappeared. I went to the room for the morning darshan. I prepared a small slip to Swami. This is what happened with my ice cream. See how the interaction with Swami goes. Morning, Sunday morning darshan, he came. And he looked, I was sitting there. Said like this. Went, interacted with a few people, came that side. My letter was there in between the palms. He came with a small 2 fingers. He put that out. He just looked into it like that and said, smiled and said, like that, he said, don't mind. So he has accepted that my giving the ice cream to the child was an offering to none other than himself. Well, these are some small things which in life, which could be very petty, but then touching and ever in your heart, mind and soul, which can never be deleted. Calling about being a savior, coming up to you to bring about everything. It was way back again in the 90s when we were in Muscat, myself, Uma, my wife, and young Vishnu sitting behind in my Mitsubishi Gallant. We were on the weekend drive to my brother's place. Halfway down, I think my brother knows about Ibri and Muscat and all Ruby. So we were reaching Nizwa halfway down, and a long jam, traffic jam, about more than a mile or so, cars, inch to inch, bumper to bumper. And it was about 2 hours before sunset. And as we inched across and reached the place where the actual thing was, it was a wadi crossing. Wadis are flash floods, you know, in Muscat. The rains would have happened somewhere else, but the flash floods would come through the mountains and cross that area. And they are marked out with poles, red, white danger zone. So as we reached there, the cops were all there, but then I didn't want to dare go about it. The water is almost to the danger level. But the cops were saying, you got a big car, smaller car went out. You should go. You can't stop the traffic. I prayed to Swami, went in according to the protocol or how they in the wadi, you should drive in the second gear and should not be applying brakes and all that. It should go at a very slow speed. A bakery van was just opposite, about 10 feet, which you may need to maintain the distance in wadis. That bakery van stopped. That fellow got out of the window and is sitting on top of the bakery. And I cannot turn because this current of the wadi power was very powerful. It could wash away cars. If I take a turn, maybe I'll be washed out. I didn't know what to do. In a fraction of a second, the car stopped. Engine stopped. The water was level, was hitting the window. We were shouting for help. Nobody to hear. Halfway down the wadi, in between. Vishnu from behind, he got up and he said, Dad, Swami's picture is there in front. Why don't you pray? He just said that Swami is there to pray to Swami. Started the car, it didn't start. Then he said, Dad, put off the headlights. A young boy, he never knows about driving. But then he prompted me, put off the headlights and start the car. And lo, it started. And we started saying, Sai Ram, Sai Ram, Sai Ram, and all that. As it was on a boat, we crossed, reached the other end of the wadi, safe and sound. There were so many locals there, standing there. One of them came and said, in Arabic, Kefan titlam el maut? How did you come out of this death? The other person there in Arabic replied, Haza tartib min Allah. It's God who's protected them. So you can never tell how, when, where. He's always there to support you, to bring about everything into you in our lives. Coming to about how you can love and reach Swami, I think each one has got his own ways of understanding, experiencing Swami. And that's how I think we are all here. In some form or the other, Swami has touched everybody's life. So similarly, I would just want to go about certain dreams of mine with Swami, which very fondly he always comes in, sometimes just appears and disappears, but sometimes are very significant, a few of which I will just narrate. It's about Swami appearing in my dream. That was about to be on a Thursday morning. It was in Satya Sai Institute of Higher Medical Sciences that he appeared, and he showed me a small little brown stone of Ganesha, and it disappeared. I didn't know what it was. I went for the normal routine work at 11:30. I come back for a cup of coffee or something, or for lunch, and get back to work. I was going back. There was nobody on the road, on the quarters road to the hospital. I heard a voice. I'm in front of you. Pick me up and take me. I didn't know who it was. I just turned back and nobody was there. I ignored and I walked two steps. In a loud and harsh voice, didn't I tell you I was there? I'm here. Pick me up and take me home. I didn't know again. I was confused. The third time it was very harsh. Nenu ikkada unnanu. Nee kaalla munda tu rendu adugulu mundu unnanu. Nannu teeskellu, in Telugu it was. That time I was a little perturbed, disturbed, and fear, out of fear, stopped and looked in front of me. And on the tarmac, I mean, I can say that, you know, how you have these driveways, sitting there was a brown stone, this much, about an inch wide. I stooped. The same voice said, pick me up. So I lifted it, and to my surprise, on the stone were two big ears, a big belly, a trunk. I took it, went for work, came back home, The first thing I don't know, but I put it there in the altar. Swami comes into the dream and says, Deggarunchuko, appudu pooja chey. Pray. 2 weeks later, the same thing came, but in a smaller size, just about the size of this fingertip, this much. It's a black, same Ganesha. Same words, same sequence. That too came to my house. And I still have them at home. That's how it happens with Swami. You can never tell what and why he's giving this to you. Only thing is, we have to bow down and surrender and say, thank you, Swami. On dreams about Jyotirlingas, a very touching in my life, which never happened earlier. It was during the time when we used to watch this Harahara Mahadev in TV. One of the night I had a dream of Swami showing his 12 fingers like this. And twice he showed me 12. I didn't understand. Dunnaputa, he said something, Dunnaputa, you don't understand. The second time again, same thing repeated. And then he waved with a wave of his hand. He put out in his palm, I found a small linga in his palm. Then he said, again, this disappeared. And then he showed me again 12. I didn't understand. Then he showed me specifically how the Jyotirlingas in each place are, the shape of them. And then he told me, go and see them. And the dream was over. A few days later, I was wondering, contemplating on this, what is this Jyotirlingas and all that. And I was planning how to go about it. It so happened that during the counseling session, I was interacting with somebody who knows somebody in Rameshwaram. And I was telling how to go about this darshan and all that. Then that patient's father and mother, they're from Maharashtra. The child had an ASD, congenital heart defect. They were waiting for counseling. And about 5 minutes like that, I was talking on the phone. And then after I talked, he said, you want to go and visit Jyotirlingas? I'll arrange it for you in Maharashtra. So somehow Rameshwaram was kept aside little and went to Maharashtra. And that's how slowly, one by one, we happened to be visiting, myself and Uma, we did that. Well, on the Rameshwaram trip, I will recall, Swami came into my dream and said, I'm taking your Rudrakshamalas. You know, I got this, I don't know why, but then I got them, I didn't buy them. I'm taking your Rudrakshamalas. I said, why should you do that? I went to Rameshwaram, drove to Rameshwaram after a week about. I go for the Samudra Sana. I take 3 dips. And on the 3rd dip, when I came up, I saw 2 of these Rudrakshamalas floating in front of me, and the tide was high enough. I quickly rushed to pick up. I could only hold on to one. The other one floated into the sea. I was very angry with Swami. Swami, I said, you can't do this. And you did it. Why give it? Why take it? I couldn't accept it. Anyway, finished, went after the, snana of the wells, different travel. You go inside for the darshan. The Svatikalinga darshanam was there. And that was also over. And I was the only person sitting in front of the sanctum on the gadpa, the footstep. And I put my forehead there and they said, Swami, why did you have to do this? I'm still complaining, not praying. The chief priest, the person who came with me as an acquaintance, bought a big full of milk for the Abhishekam. The chief priest started pouring from there and started looking at me. And he said, pointing something at me. I didn't understand. And he said, look down. I looked down at the place where I put my head. Lo, there was one small Rudraksha there. It was not there when I put my head. A few minutes later, it is appearing and it is there. Then he sent the other Chota priest, go bring that. He took it over that milk and he showed me, I'm offering it to Shiva, and sent it back to me for prasadam. No way that I accepted. I said, what is this? You took a full mala of me and you're giving me, bargaining me with one? No way I can take it. I was not satisfied. Okay, all done. Started walking out. I came out of the temple. An elderly man again taps me from behind and in Tamil. Hey, Dr. La, I said, Amma, sir. Address kudanga, sir. Telephone number kudanga, sir. I thought maybe he's an old patient of Satya Sai Institute and he wants to communicate. He bought me a paper, a pen, and gave my address and phone number to him. Sir, 5 days later, in the post, an envelope comes in. Guess what? This comes with vibhuti inside. Now, I thought, Swami, you must excuse me for all this, but then you know why you took it and why you sent it back to me. Thank you, Swami. You're more than what I can look upon in this world. Well, I'll go to one more instance of Trayambakeshwar. Really more touching. How much time do I have? I have a lot to say, but then could we go for about 15 minutes more? Yeah, okay, fine, thank you. I'll try to make it concise. It was in Trayambakeshwar that one of the darshans, when we had been to Mumbai, and I thought 1 day is free, let me drive out to Trayambakeshwar. I took a taxi early morning. I called the priest. The priest said, you'll be here before 7 o'clock. But somehow I managed to reach there only at 7:40 because the chief priest would come at 8 o'clock. And that time nobody would be allowed into the sanctum for Abhishekams. So, but somehow 7:40 I reached there. 7:45 quickly I had to change my dress. All these Rudrakshas got entangled in my ganjam, sacred thread. I removed my kurta and banyan that was not coming out. So I removed all these and kept them there, quickly changed, went inside, finished the Abhishekam little bit and came out. But then I saw such a big bunch of grapes. Unbelievable. I haven't seen such a kind of big bunch offered to the Lord there. And I just came outside. I was happy that the Dakshina was over. Abhishekam was over and came out. And quick, I wore my kurta and this one. I forgot the Rudrakshas, everything there in that period. The whole temple was full of devotees. I did not even remember to collect these. I drove out. 9 kilometers away, on the way back, suddenly I felt emptiness in my around my neck. Put my hand, nothing was there. I got scared. I told the driver, please turn back and drive fast. We reached there, and to my surprise, these were not touched. Anybody could have lifted all these. Nobody touched. It was still there. I was very happy. He said, thank you, Swami. Put them on. Again, changed to my loincloth because you only had to wear one cloth to go inside. Went inside, prayed to Swami, and a little bit of water to the lingams there. The priest touched my shoulder and said, "Your prasad le jao." What the big bunch of grapes which I first saw before. He put it into a carry bag and gave me a prasad le jao. Happy I was, I came outside. Sir, you will not, ladies, brothers and sisters, you will not believe. Such a huge bunch of grapes came out, steps down from the sanctum side. One by one, somebody coming prasad do. And I gave each one grape. You will not believe, I was left with only one grape and nobody else to ask for. Then I thought, Swami made me come back for these people to get this prasad from Lord Shiva Bholenath. Now that's the love of divine. How he gives, how he makes things, and how for the person who was unexpecting all these things got his grace through one of the grape. In Parli Vaidyanath, one of the dreams which came was, Swami showed me the sanctum full of bilupatra, flowers, coconut shells, whatnot. And so it looks so dirty rather. I'm sorry, Swami, but it is what you said, that it was dirty and you have to clean it in the dream. So maybe after 2 weeks, much of these trips, Uma did not accompany me because she was not feeling well or something because of college. She couldn't make all these trips. But then I went there. I told the priest there. I had a priest there. I told him, he said, you come, no problem. You come by 6 a.m. in the morning. I slept in the nearby hotel. I couldn't sleep. 1 o'clock, I got up. I finished my ablutions. 3 o'clock, I was up with my dhoti and everything ready. I went to the walk to the temple. The security fellow wouldn't open the gate. I said, I pleaded, please, let me come inside. Let me have penance inside. No. 5 baje aao. I sat there on the steps, disappointed, dejected, prayed to Swami. Sir, ladies, Sai brothers and sisters, from inside, a voice to the security in Marathi. I was go under, you know, that sound came, chodo, or something like that. Then he came to me and said, Are bhai, mant bola rahe aapko. Jao, andar jao. He opened the lock and as I quickly rushed to the sanctum, a young boy, I think he's nothing more than 20 years. And in Parli Vaidyanath, it is a custom there that one priest is chosen for every year as the chief priest. And this young boy was for that 1 year as a priest. So he said, Jaldi aao mere piche. I ran behind him. He opened the sanctum doors. You will not believe it is the same scenario what Swami showed me of the temple around the lingam. He quickly threw a jadu at me. Pakdo, saaf karo isko pura, kuch bhi nahi rehna idhar. And he gave me that butta, what they call. Said, put them inside. Sir, maybe I did not do this penance in my own house, but I did it there. Pani dalunga. Saaf karo. Buckets of water, he started pouring. Clean. Then came the lingam. He said, I'll pour water. Not a little bit of grease or anything should be there on the lingam. Wash it. 3 times he made me scrub the lingam. Done. Threw a towel at me and said, wipe it dry. All this happened. And then he gave me gandam, chandanam, to be applied. Made do whatever alankaram you want to do. I did it. He was happy. Then I put some chandanam on the top of the lingam. Then he gave one bilupatra, kept it there. He gave few akshitas and said, put on the lingam. I closed my eyes and offered it. Within a second or maybe 2 seconds, he hit me like that. Hey, aankh khol ke dekho na. Aankh kya band kiya? I thought maybe he wants me to open my eyes and pray to God. I opened my second time also, same thing, and then again hit me. I said, kya pagal hai kya to? Dekho udhar. You will not believe in my astonishment. There was on top of the lingam, the akshitas fell as om. Very clearly, vividly. And he said, ye Bholenath ka chamatkar hai. Aise cheez kabhi bhulna nahi to. Aang ban karke kya karega? 20-year-old boy, maybe. But then this is what happened. And yes, he prepared a lamp, 3 rounds, kept it to the side, aarti. I sang Swami's bhajan there, Swami's aarti. Sai Ram, Sai Ram. Till now I can see Swami standing in the orange robes above the lingam during the arati. What more can I ask? All he showed and he made it happen. How? I don't want to ask him. He gave. That's more in my life. I will quickly go to Krishneshwar. At Krishneshwar, the priest again, I was driving from Washam to Krishneshwar. It's about 7 hours, 5 minutes, right? It's about 6 hours drive. At about 2 o'clock, I left Washam. He said, you have to be here before 7:30 because no offerings will be made to the deity after 7:30 p.m. But I reached there just about 10 minutes to 8. He said, no, you cannot enter the temple now. I have to close. I denied arrogantly. I removed this one, wore the panche and walked into the temple, removed all the rudrakshas around Lingam, removed the bilpatra from top. A small apprentice boy, what they called who learned the Veda, was inside the temple, accompanying me in the garbhagudi. And I asked him, give me some water. He looked this side, that side. He found a small lota containing water. Hardly about maybe 10, 15 ml of water was there in that. I took it and poured and chanted two of my whatever I could. He lit a lamp. I gave a lamp. Dasdash. Same aarti which I sang, again it was Swami standing there. The chief priest was shouting from there, Dr. Saab, abhi aao, public mere ko bahut bolenge, aap kaisa band nahi kiye, jaldi aao. So after I finished the aarti, came outside very happy. The young boy came and started praying in front of Lord and facing me. I said, you don't do that. Do it to him. You have the greatest opportunity in your life to be here in this sanctum. Do it every day. And that's how Swami is. I think many more are there. One last, I'll finished off with Somnath Temple. I went to Swami with a letter saying that I'm Swami, I'm going to Somnath Temple. Please bless us. I was sitting by the side of Dr. Gadia. He's no more now. He was sitting next to me. I didn't tell him anything about the Somnath trip. I just put a letter, note, small note. He asked me, are you going to Somnath, Gujarat? Somnath ko ja rahe kya? I didn't know how he's asking me about this. I said, yes. Are bhai, Swami ne wahan pe gaya tha, 70s mein. Wahan pe he materialized one lingam and said, this is the actual lingam which I'm materializing in. So that is still there. You ask the chief priest, he will give it, he will show it to you. Yaad rakke mai poocha. The chief priest refused. There was another priest by the side there who was supposed to take over from this priest for the next session. And he was gazing at me all through. After this priest left, he came with a plate and that lingam in that, Swami materialized lingam, with flowers and bilpatra over it. He quickly said, hatao, jaldi prarthana karke dado. I removed the first, there I found this lingam, which Swami materialized. He said, haath mein lo. I took it. Rakho. I did it. Kept it back quickly. Abhi santusht hai? How does he know about this? I never told him. I never asked him. But then that is Swami. I came back and I told, next visit, I told Gadia, sir, Dr. Saab, aap jo bole na, aisa sa hua. Are Swami, tab kyun darte yaar? He is there to grant everything to you. Just surrender. Well, I think I covered quite a lot, and brother was saying it's just 5 minutes. There's much more where I could have. I'll just briefly conclude with the Atirudra Mahayagnam. It was happening in Puttaparthi. I went there once. I was so happy that everybody is getting an opportunity to do something there. I said, Swami, give me an opportunity. The next time it was in Vrindavan, and I was offered to be the medical officer in charge. I mean, for the Ritviks and general devotees for emergencies, 24/7 for all the days. One Ruthvik came to me the second day with a sore throat and all that. I'm not able to chant. I gave him the regular little medication. I said, I gave him some vibhuti and said, chalo. This was in the afternoon session. 11 o'clock, he came to me after the session was aarti was over. 3 o'clock, he went back to the Yagashala. The next day morning, he came to me. I thought he wants to asking me for more medicines. Said, nahi. Sob theek hai. Kal, afternoon itself, I'm all right. I'm able to chant. And then from his bag, he removed a Rudraksha mala. And he told me that I went to Rishikesh long time back. One sadhu gave me this and I'm keeping it still. I didn't wear it. I felt like giving it to you. I'm giving it to you. He chanted little Rudram and put that in my. That is the second Rudraksha which is here. And I went and met our chief priest, Nanju the Dikshit, for the Atirudra Mahayagnam. I said, I want to offer some Rudrakshas. That same day, Srinivas Chettiar came from Madurai with Padukas and Rudrakshas. And he told the person next to him, give him some Rudrakshas. I didn't ask. He asked, gave me. Then the next morning, I gave it to Nanjana Dixit. He kept it at the feet of Lord for the Abhishekam. I forgot about it. On the 10th day, I asked him, sir, where are my Rudrakshas? Ah, you didn't get it. Ramu did not give you. That Ramu, the other priest, he did not give you. I said, no. Ramu said, I did not find them, he said. You told me, but I went and I couldn't find them. He walked briskly to the lingam, removed the flowers. You will not believe, so the 5 Rudrakshas were there in place. He said, Ramu, you didn't see this. Sir, every day morning we are cleaning. Every day Abhishekam is going on. We know what is being removed. But then he took that and gave me. I think with this, there much more I can say, but I know it's more time. I've taken 5 minutes extra. Thanks, Swami, for all what you have given. And I wish you could just have the nice melody of music of Swami with Maula or Maula. My complete humble offering at his lotus feet. After that, I conclude. Sai Ram.
Dil kahe tum
So thank you, Dr. Rao Garu. That was a wonderful talk and a good music also. That's one of my favorite songs, you know, by Rathod. So it's a very rich experience you have. And unfortunately, because of time limit, we can see that we can only probably scratch the surface. So we'd like to have you come another day and continue with this talk. But again, you know, what a beautiful experiences you have. There's a lot of parallels in so many Samarpans we hear with Swami, but also uniqueness. Each one is so unique in its own way. And somehow it connects to each one of us in your own unique way. So thanks again for coming by. We really thank you. And we like to felicitate you. So Brother Balasubramaniam will give you a token. Please do come here, sir. You can stand near the Ganesha. Right. Please, you want to? So just to say what he said that Shirdi Baba told him that, you know, we are all just chokidars, which is the, you know, guardsmen. So we are nothing more than that. That's what he's saying. So none of us have any special privileges in front of the Lord. So appreciate that message. And likewise, as you said, your pillar of support, you know, Dr. Uma Devi is here. So we like to felicitate her as well. So Sister Padma Garu can, where is... Maybe Yeah, Mahesh, can you, sorry, give the shawl? No, no, we have one more.
No,
so
we have one more, but yeah. I feel this is the first special guest.
Yeah. Yeah, please, you come. No, no, that's okay. Well, that is between you and her, but as far as the center is concerned, please. So if you don't mind, can you go on the lady side? Also, I would like to recognize, we have another pretty significant guest here today. We have Mr. C.H. Narasimha Murthy. Sir, if you can please stand up for a minute for all of us to see. Sairam. So, sir is a retired chief engineer of Andhra Pradesh State Electricity Board, which in equivalent here will be probably like the CEO of a utility company, or if it's a law, it'll be probably like attorney general of the state, you know, something like that. It's a pretty prominent position in India to be a chief engineer of electricity board. More important than that, he was in charge of the electrical power connections to the super specialty hospital in Puttaparthi in 1990-91, working with Colonel Joga Rao, who was a chief, you know, for Swami to execute these projects, as well as Sri Chakravarti Garu, who is now, you know, the chairman of the Global Council. So perhaps one day we'd like to hear your experiences as well, if you have the time to permit to us. And another significant part of it is that his wife is Srimati Subbalakshmi. She's also here. So, and she happens to be the younger sister of Dr. Andavelu, Dr. Rao. So Dr. Rao has a full plate this weekend between his co-brother and sister-in-law and brother-in-law. And so, and coincidentally, he lost his voice, by the way, you know. So with that, I think we conclude our program, and we'd like to have sir do an aarti. And then after that, we will have our prasadam downstairs. Okay. Sairam, and thanks again for everybody. Sairam.